Here.
Commissioner Peck.
Here.
Please rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance and a moment of silence.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, thank you. At this time, we have the Citizens Forum. This is where anyone from the public can come up and speak on anything not on today's agenda. If you will just step up to the podium and give us your name and address. Seeing that there is none, we have no awards and proclamations, so we will move on to public hearings and items scheduled for a certain time.
Item 5.1, public hearing on petition number 4320, requesting vacation of a portion of the Broadway Boulevard and North Street right-of-way at the northwest corner of the Broadway Boulevard-North Street intersection. Sub-item 5.1A, first reading ordinance number 09-10520.
Okay, at this time, I'll open the public hearing. Mr. Andrew.
Thank you, Mayor and Commissioners. This petition was filed by Roger Bakta. He's the owner of the Best Inn, formerly known as the 8140 Motel. It's at the northwest corner of Broadway and North Street. And the US 81 bypass, or Broadway, was a KDOT constructed project in the 1930s, and they went out and acquired right-of-way for that. And at the northwest corner, where North Street was old US 40, a motel was built in the late 1940s, and it was constructed with a zero setback, which meant that really the motel patron parking in front of the units was actually located a good part of it on the right-of-way. And what you used to have there before it was redone was a free right turn, a sweeping curve that carried southbound traffic west onto North Street. And when that corridor was reconstructed, that curve was taken out, and the area was restored back to grass. Since that time, Mr. Bakta reported that he was having some drainage problems and also saw it as an opportunity to reconfigure his parking. So we told him the first step was to file a petition and ask the City Commission to declare that portion to be surplus, unneeded right-of-way. He did that, but then when we did the research, we determined that it was still owned by KDOT, not by us. And a year later of discussions and negotiations with KDOT, they have deeded all that right-of-way over to us. And so last year, the City Commission didn't take any action. They asked staff to obtain a quick claim deed from KDOT, which we did. And then we helped Mr. Bakta submit a new petition. Now that the city has secured title. So we took the petition, we distributed it to all the public and franchise utilities. Nobody has any utilities in that area, and we don't need the extra area to maintain the roadways there. Cox Cable did request a 10-foot utility easement at the far east end. But because this is no longer needed for roadway maintenance purposes and there's no utilities present, our recommendation would be to approve the attached ordinance on first reading, and that would basically transfer ownership of the parking lot back to Mr. Bakta so he can maintain it. With that, I'd be happy to address any questions.
Questions of Mr. Andrew?
This is an old picture in here, correct? This isn't the
This is an old picture. I think there's two things. It depicts the what the property would be with the vacation, and we couldn't find a aerial photo that showed the sweeping curve taken out of there. Both our 2005 and our 2007 photos still showed it, but the work began in the summer of 2007 after our most recent photo, and so it's all green space and slope today.
And what kind of reconfiguring? I drove by there. I was wondering if he mentioned what his parking problems currently were.
Well, his His main parking problem is that most of his stalls that he had there were on public property, and so he didn't have a lot of freedom to reconfigure, extend paving, or deal with his drainage because he was having to deal with us out in the right-of-way. This will transfer ownership to him, and he will finish up with his final grading and edging up his paving.
Okay, and I'm a little unclear on where it extends to currently. I noticed there's quite a bit of semi-traffic that drives over his freshly seeded grass. Does this have anything to do with his ability to mitigate that problem?
I think it will allow him to do some self-help as far as just having edges and barriers to his concern was finding out how far out he could go and then putting up some kind of edge to his parking lot, because that's what's happening is people were driving off the edges and tearing up grass and dirt. And this will, if once it's under his ownership and control, he'll do some things to establish a boundary there.
Okay.
Additional questions? Thank you. I'll open it up to public comment. If not, I will close the public hearing and I will bring it back to the commission for action.
Mayor, I move we adopt ordinance number 09-10520, requesting vacation of a portion of the Broadway Boulevard and North Street right away at the northwest corner of the Broadway Boulevard and North Street intersection adjacent to the Best Inn Motel.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded on first reading to adopt ordinance number 09-10520 as presented. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed say nay. Motion passes 5-0.
Mayor, I'd like to amend the agenda today and add an administrative item of 8.6 and also an executive session.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we amend our agenda. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed say nay. Motion passes. We'll proceed then with the consent agenda.
Item 6.1, approve the minutes of September 28, 2009.
Mayor, I make a motion that we approve the consent agenda.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to accept the consent agenda. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed say nay. Motion passes 5-0. There is no development business, so we'll move on to administration.
Item 8.1, second reading ordinance number 09-10519, annexing South 9th Street from the southern boundary of Riffle Addition south to Waterwell Road.
This ordinance was passed on first reading September the 28th, and since that time no comments have been received. Is there any public comment at this time? If not, I will go ahead and bring it back to the commission for action.
Mayor, I move we adopt ordinance number 09-10519 on second reading.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we adopt ordinance number 09-10519, annexing the South 9th Street from the southern boundary of Riffle Addition south to Waterwell Road on second reading. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Will the clerk please call the roll?
Commissioner Angel?
Aye.
Commissioner Arbke?
Aye.
Commissioner Jennings?
Aye.
Commissioner Peck?
Aye.
Mayor Larson?
Aye. Motion passes 5-0.
Item 8.2, first reading ordinance number 09-10518, amending Chapter 8, Article 3, Division 3, Section 8-191 of the Salina Code, pertaining to exemptions from skilled trade contracting and trade licensing.
Mr. Roberts.
Thank you, Mayor, Commissioners. Presently, our current licensing structures requires that owners of commercial property have any plumbing, electrical, or mechanical work that they want to have done on those properties be done by a licensed skilled trade contractor. That would be different than someone who merely holds a license as a journeyman or a master in a skilled trade. It requires a contractor's license. None of the current exemptions in the list that we have now would allow a person that holds a master's license in a particular trade to do any of that kind of work on their own commercial properties unless they were also licensed as a skilled trades contractor. We were approached by an individual stakeholder asking if it would be possible to create a new exemption that would allow such work to take place. We brought that to the Building Advisory Board, and after the board offered the stakeholder an opportunity to provide input and discuss his reasons for it, the board agreed that a licensed master should have the skill set to do the work, and that requiring a contractor license for them to work on their own property was overburdensome, considering that the reason for the contractor licensing is to verify insurance requirements. And since the property owner carries their own property insurance, they felt like that was unnecessary. After discussing it at length, the board did agree that some kind of an exemption should be created, but that exemption should only apply to the licensed master himself and not to any of his employees that might be working under his direction. Any of the work that required skilled trade would have to be done hands-on by that master. The master could still, though, utilize his employees to help with some of the labor work involved in projects such as changing a furnace, changing a water heater, doing some electrical additions to a building. They could carry materials for him, demolish installations, but he would have to do all the work pertaining to the new installations. The board did agree to create that exemption. We've provided copies of the minutes for your consideration in the staff report. We brought the original question to the board in August. They asked us to draft language for their consideration, which we brought back to them in September, and they subsequently approved. We have forwarded them to you for your consideration. We would recommend that the City Commission adopt Ordinance 09-10-518 to create this new exemption, and I'd be happy to answer any questions that you have of me at this time.
Questions of Mr. Roberts?
I think the only question that I had was that hypothetical, you have contractor, say as electrical contractor, and they want to really redo their warehouse area. If I really understand this right, and they're just going to pull down lighting and redo lighting, then that would be something that they could do, but only the owner, only that one person. So I want to make sure that if I understand that in that case, that's what was planned, and he can't use other help from within the corporation to assist on the project, and it wouldn't be enforced that way.
Yeah, that's a great question, Commissioner, and I probably failed one important thing here that I failed to identify is that under our current licensing requirements, what we're talking about here is work that requires a permit. The owner of a property can do minor electrical, plumbing, and mechanical work that does not require a permit, such as changing out switches or plugs or changing light fixtures. That doesn't require a permit, but the running of new circuits and the installation of new utilization equipment would require a permit, and that is what, under our licensing, they wouldn't be allowed to do. And so in your illustration of changing out the lights in a warehouse, he could use unskilled labor to help him set the lights down and hoist the new lights up, but he would actually have to do the wiring of, if they were adding new lights, mm-hmm. that he would have to actually be running the conduit and doing all that work himself rather than having labor do that for him. So.
And that was where I was having trouble wrapping my head around it. It's permit work. Anything that requires a permit.
That is correct.
Okay. So if someone is remodeling an addition, a small addition to their home that would require a permit, they have to be hold a license, correct? Contractor's license.
Actually, that is one of the exemptions that owners of single-family dwellings can do any work.
No, without. He's doing it for somebody else. He is building an addition at someone else's home.
Yes.
He has to have.
Yes.
And it is because of the insurance, is basically how I understood you to say that.
Right. The contractor licensing provisions anticipates two things: having an individual working for the company that has the skill set to be able to do that work, and then secondarily, that the company holds the required amount of liability insurance for the protection of the property owner. And so though both those things have to happen, well, if I'm a licensed master, plumbing, electrical, or mechanical master, mm-hmm. I have the skill set, but if I don't carry the license, and when we first proposed this, the first reaction of the board, well, everybody, if they're a master, they probably have a contracting license. They're the master of their own company, but there are a lot of masters that work for other companies, or they may be retired, and they're still property mm-hmm. owners. They still maintain their license, but they don't have the contracting license. They have their skilled trades license, but not their contracting license
okay.
to do business.
Okay, I get it.
What were you starting to say about an owner of a single-family dwelling?
One of the exemptions in the current skilled trade licensing requirements is that the owner of an owner-occupied single-family detached dwelling can do any of that work themselves, and they don't have to hire licensed contractors. Even if that work requires a permit, they still have to have the inspections, but they're able to do the work themselves without contracting with a skilled trades contractor.
Do they have to be licensed?
No.
So he can work on his own house,
doing any work that he's confident that he can do.
Okay. But he can't come to my house and do anything because he doesn't have a license.
That's correct.
Okay.
That's actually exemption number 4, and it's reflected in the language of the ordinance you have in front of
right.
you, just because it exists mm-hmm. already.
I just wanted to make sure that there wouldn't be cases where the project was of such a nature that licensed person has another licensed skilled person, and they, you know, under the scenario I was talking about, maybe they completely change their light utilization that does run new circuits, and then they come back and say, well, gee, I didn't understand it that way. I really want my people to help me to do this project.
Actually, that was discussed at length,
okay, good.
Commissioner, and they felt like even if they had licensed journeymen working for them, but they're not a contracting company in that skilled trade, but for some reason they've got somebody else retired that works for them that's got a journeyman's license, they didn't even want to go there. The exemption was created. They thought that was getting a little too far afield, and crafted the exemption just for the master himself so that he could do that work, and felt like that was broad enough to satisfy the goals of the stakeholder.
Well, and even though I realize that this is a summary of the minutes that happened on August the 11th, it says that the meeting was called to order at 4 and you adjourned at 5:45. Is this all you talked about, or was there other? Because it seems to me like
no, there were other items on the agenda besides that. Was not the only agenda item.
Okay, they fully digested this, I take it.
There was quite a bit of discussion on this particular.
Tell.
We spent quite a bit of time on this one issue.
Okay, I appreciate that because there's people here from all different walks of life and professions, so I imagine that you discussed it at length.
Well, and seeing as that there are several skilled trade people that sit on the building advisory
right.
board, they
right.
had a number of questions about that, you know, and they wanted to make sure were what they were actually being asked to consider.
Right, right. That's what I wanted to point out. Any other questions of Mr. Roberts? Thank you. At this time, I'll open it up to public comment. Seeing that there is none, I will go ahead and bring it back to the commission for action.
Mayor, I move we adopt ordinance number 0910518 on first reading as recommended by staff and the Building Advisory Board.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to adopt on first reading ordinance number 09-10518. Amending Chapter 8, Article 3, Division 3, Section 8-191 of the Salina Code pertaining to exemptions from skilled trade contracting and trade licensing. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay. Motion passes 5-0.
Mayor, if I might, I didn't want to sidetrack the conversation, but this is representative of one of the opportunities to have input on in terms of code requirements. It's amending codes that are in place. We're also involved in the code adoption process, and we're soliciting stakeholder input
actively for the upcoming codes. I think this is also representative of the Building Advisory Board in terms of how seriously they take their role as well as the codes. They deliberated quite a bit on this topic to end up with the recommendation that they brought to you.
That was why I asked those questions also. I imagine that they talked about this at length, and they knew that this was going to be discussed at the meeting, and I appreciate all their legwork and research on this, so thank you.
Item 8.3, approval of an engineering agreement for supervisory control and data acquisition at the Water and Wastewater Treatment Plant, project number 092780.
Ms. Tasker.
Thank you, Mayor and Commissioners. A supervisory control and data acquisition system, or what we refer to as a SCADA system, in a nutshell, is a computer system for gathering and analyzing real-time data. SCADA systems such as are proposed at the water plant and wastewater plant are complex due to the intricacy of the system's monitor and control. The water treatment plant SCADA system was first installed in the mid-1980s to monitor the gravity filters and was last updated in 2003 to monitor additional treatment equipment. For example, at the water treatment plant, when we get an alarm, that information is transferred to a central location where staff can determine what the alarm is, what analysis has been done, what control has been accomplished, and it puts it into a logical and realistic means for staff to evaluate. Currently, the processor at the water treatment plant is over 20 years old, and in 2007 it was deemed to be obsolete, so virtually it's very difficult and costly to find parts for that piece of equipment. At the wastewater treatment plant, we do not have a SCADA system. There, virtually, we have a monitoring system that's located at each building or process. For example, there, when we have an alarm, we get an alarm at the annunciator panel in the operator's building. Staff goes and looks and sees where that alarm is at, and then from there, they go to the specific building to determine what the cause or the problem is. No central location or control is available. At the wastewater treatment plant, our goal is to become more efficient and eventually reduce staffing costs. Staff has obtained a preliminary proposal for the SCADA improvements at the water treatment and wastewater treatment plant. The proposals were very complex, and staff feels it would be best if we got some additional engineering help to take a look at those so that the improvements would mesh in with our existing equipment and meet our goals and objectives of the project in a cost-effective manner. A design team of Wilson & Company, the R.E. Pedrotti Company, and utility staff would evaluate concepts to achieve the desired level of instrumentation at both the water treatment plant and the wastewater plant. Once we've determined the best means to meet these requirements, a final cost proposal would be brought back to the City Commission for approval prior to any work being accomplished at either facility. The agreement before you today for the SCADA system improvements is written in a cost-plus fixed-fee format with an amount not to exceed of $16,892. Budget allocations were included in the 2009 Capital Improvement Program, $155,000 for upgrading the SCADA at the water treatment plant and $320,000 for upgrading or new SCADA at the wastewater treatment plant, which totals $475,000. In our original estimate, we estimated $450,000 for the construction and $25,000 for the design. It is recommended that the City Commission approve the engineering agreement with Wilson & Company engineers and architects in the amount not to exceed of $16,892. Mark Peterson with Wilson & Company is here today, and at this time, Mark and I would be glad to answer any questions you might have.
Questions of Ms. Tasker?
So we need a team to decide this?
Well, I guess in a nutshell, the proposals were fairly complicated, and our staff didn't feel comfortable evaluating that proposal and determining that it really met our needs. So virtually, Wilson & Company will really provide us that technical advisory information to develop a good proposal. And the R.E. Pedrotti Company is the equipment supplier that we currently have for all of our equipment at the water treatment plant, and to try to tie back into that is where we're headed. So I don't know if a team is the right word, but these individuals would be involved in determining that final, most cost-effective project.
Okay. Is it such that Pedrati just simply provided too many options? I guess my ultimate question is, I would think that the supplier could come in here and help evaluate the situation, say, yeah, ultimately, this is really the system you ought to go with. But that's not the case, necessarily.
They did provide us with some information, and actually, it's technical enough that I don't feel comfortable saying this does everything we need it to do. There may be some additional options we should have looked at, and there are some options that we may not need.
Okay.
And our staff just truly didn't feel comfortable making those decisions for $500,000 worth of work, in a nutshell.
Okay. Good enough.
So what does the lifetime look like for this equipment? I mean, we're going to be working on the wastewater treatment plant probably in the next 5 to 10 years. How is this going to fit in that plan?
This equipment that we're installing will phase right on into that project as we move forward, and that's part of the help that I'd like to get from Wilson and Company to make sure that we are using the state-of-the-art equipment that does have those capabilities. Okay. They're more familiar with this type of work and do it day in and day out as opposed to us every 5-10 years.
Okay. Thank you.
I was curious on the summary expense section there, and I'm probably just not understanding how it's laid out, but there is a total markup of $2,500, and then ultimately that is what our discount is as well. I wasn't sure how that.
It is the very same. That 15% is what was agreed to as the discount, and Greg may be able to hit that a little harder. Him and I talked about this.
Martha and I spoke about that in terms of trying to reflect that in a way that it was as clear as possible, and we may not have quite hit the mark, but that is intended to reflect or to show you what it would have been and what it is by virtue of the application of the terms of the settlement this contract is viewed as falling under that as well, as far as there not being the
I see that over here. Never mind. I see the breakdown of the markup. Okay.
So we net out as though it had not ever been applied.
Okay.
Additional questions? Thank you. I will open it up now to public comment. Seeing that there is none, I'll go ahead and bring it back to the commission for action.
One last thing. What is the what does OH cost mean?
Overhead.
Okay, that's what I was guessing. On site visits, there's $918 in overhead costs, and then in meeting with the city, there's $520 worth of overhead costs. What kind of overhead?
I may ask Mark to explain that.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Mark Peterson, electrical engineer with Wilson and Company.
Mark.
In regards to on all projects that are undertaken by a company such as ours, we have overhead costs of employee benefits and building expenses and all the normal overheads that any business does have, and there is an agreed to amount of overhead markup to the direct labor cost that has been established in previous agreements with the city and Wilson and Company, and that overhead is paying that amount of those costs. Is that make sense?
Okay, so the total overhead markup is the total overhead is 1.8%.
It's a 1.8 multiplier, yes.
Okay, Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Again, any other questions? I will bring it back to the commission for action.
Mayor, I move that we approve the engineering agreement with Wilson & Company, engineering and architects, in the amount of not to exceed $1,692.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded for an approval of an engineering agreement for the SCADA, is that pronounced right? For the SCADA at the Water and Wastewater Treatment Plant, project number 09-2780 with Wilson & Company in an amount not to exceed $16,892. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay. Motion passes 5-0.
Item 8.4, approve change order number 1 for the Chevron Energy Conservation Project number 082742.
Mr. Snyder.
Thank you, Mayor and Commissioners. The City Commission approved a contract with Chevron Energy Solutions on December 1st, 2008 for energy saving improvements and upgrades to 9 city-owned or managed buildings. This is a state program with the KCC in charge or to oversee the Facility Conservation Improvement Program, or the FCIP is normally called. The FCIP is designated for use by schools, state agencies, counties, and municipalities. The objective of the program is to provide improvements that will conserve energy and thus reduce utility bills, and the cost of any of the improvements will be recouped by the energy savings generated by the work over a set period of time. The approved contract for improvements for the 9 buildings was $1,358,187. We had a number of budget underage and owner requested changes, both adds in and deducts, with a net reduction of $138,147.51. Major areas of the budget underage occurred at the Health Department and the Police Department buildings in the HVAC project category. We also asked for and requested additional work for several city-owned buildings, as well as a reduction in the proposed work for the Bicentennial Center. The change in scope of work for the Bicentennial Center was due to the proposed improvements currently under contract. And when this FCIP, the energy audit, was performed, the investment grade audit, excuse me, was underway in the summer of 2008, those proposed improvements currently in progress were unknown. This project was bonded, and the language in the bonds stated that the identified the use of the funds for improvements for lighting, HVAC, natural gas, or water systems. In the FCIP project, plumbing fixtures were purchased for the Bicentennial Center, but were not installed. They were stored, and then pending the current construction project. The phase two work at the Bicentennial Center does include considerable HVAC and utility work, with bidding proposed in the near future. Using the available funding from the FCIP project for the specified work at the Bicentennial Center is an allowable use of these funds. The original contract with Chevron Energy Solutions would be reduced by $138,000, or $138,147.51, with those funds be applied to the HVAC work at the Bicentennial Center phase two project. Therefore, it's staff's recommendation, change order number 1 with Chevron Energy Solutions Overland Park project 08-2742 be approved, and the funds available will be used in phase two of the Bicentennial Center project. I'd be glad to try to answer any questions.
So the way I read this is at the Health Department and the Police Department, their HVAC did not need the improvements that they thought.
Well, no, I think it probably more in line that they cost less than they anticipated.
Okay.
In the budget. All improvements that were proposed in the initial contract were completed, and we had more improvements added to the contract through this last year. But in the when they bid those, they came in favorable, with actually less cost.
And so how did we decide to take that overage or that money, that savings, and apply it to the Bicentennial center. None of the other buildings qualified, or they all were within their scope of work? Everybody met?
Yeah, basically, what we had the nine identified buildings that were part of the original contract.
Right.
All those projects were completed. We actually added some other projects and reduced some other things that we considered in other buildings, like Oakdale, our general services buildings, a considerable work, Oakdale Park buildings. When we got done with everything that we could actually do, we had basically a balance of $138,000 left. And so we needed to, we could do one of two things. We could do a change order and just reduce the contract. Well, this is what we'll do. But what we're suggesting, that since we bonded that project, mm-hmm. with the language in the bond saying that money can only be used for those certain items, basically utility types, we feel it's prudent to apply those funds towards the phase two of the Bicentennial Center, because there's a considerable amount of that type of work that will take part in the phase two.
Okay.
So we could not fund it and just reduce that amount of bonds, but we felt in this case we've already bonded that project, or this dollar amount, and it fits the language of the bonding issue.
And I think that's exactly what we need to do. It's like found money, icing on the cake.
Yeah.
I just want to make sure that all the other buildings came with things were done to those buildings that they want, that you wanted to accomplish with them. Nobody was short anything, or
In fact, if you look at the page, I think it's page 3 of the 7 that are attached there, you can see the basically everything that was done, with there's some reductions in the ads that were basically Salina requested projects. So we feel we actually provided more than the initial contract stated, and they were all energy saving type measures taken.
Okay, well, I think that's great that you worked that out. Yeah. Any other questions?
We haven't voted to approve phase 2 yet, have we?
No,
I
think Marshall can probably give you a little bit of a time frame on it, but I think that's, you know, that's the next stage. If you choose not to, we just felt that if we want to do this change order, we would come to you with a change order anyway. What we're saying is that this money would be suited to be applied to that phase two because of the bonding language.
Or we could use it to reduce our debt.
That's correct.
I think that was my same basic question, is that it's an unapproved project, and does that jeopardize anything with these funds, that project's away from being presented and being approved?
The final determination on the use of funds would come at the point that we designed the phase two of the Bicentennial Center and put it out to bid and awarded those bids. But as Steve mentioned, as part of this change order, this is an opportunity to say that we would entertain use of those funds for that purpose, rather than proceeding with returning that in terms of bond funds at this point. That at the point that we have the final design, you'll have the opportunity to say we want to put it towards the debt, or we want to go forward with this project.
Mm-hmm. Well, did you answer the question how far we are from, I mean, just...
I'm sorry, I thought the concern was the use of funds.
Well, and also just a guesstimate of how far we are from phase two. Yeah. Just a guesstimate. Please. This all ties in together nicely.
Yeah. Neatly.
Phase two, my name is Marshall Perry. I'm the manager of the Bicentennial Center. Phase two is in the future. We're working on the feasibility study. We are working on the design implementation to it. It's coming up. It's not immediate, but it is coming before you in the near future. We're looking at coming up sometime later on this month with phase two plans for your discussion.
So within 6 months, 12 months?
A couple of weeks.
That phase two would start?
Phase two would be able to be starting if you approve it when we bring it to you after the discussion of the business plan next week.
Okay. Then that is very, very soon.
Yes.
Okay.
And there's just two phases, right?
At this time, yes, sir. What the city manager and the deputy city manager, myself, and the representatives from Jones, Gillum, Renz have been discussing is getting these two phases, getting the feasibility study done, so then it can be decided where we put the dollars towards, on essentially a shopping list that the feasibility study would provide for us.
Okay. So basically, if we were looking at phase two, let's just say in 6 to 8 to 12 months, we could have taken that money for debt reduction. But if it's something that's happening this quick, we can use those funds then to apply it towards phase two. Is that correct?
Correct. I don't want to mislead you. You can use those funds for debt reduction today.
Correct.
Or you could use those for six months from now.
And I understand that.
Okay. So, yes, it would be at your discretion. But with the Bicentennial Center project coming so quickly, it represents an opportunity to use those funds for Bicentennial Center improvements.
Okay. In the background.
I surprised Mike here. The other option you have is if you apply that for this project now, once we bring back the menu of other possible projects to finish out the Bicentennial Center project, you could also choose at that time to hold back on what you were going to spend and make that decision later, a little bit later in the process.
Okay.
And what's ballpark on cost of phase two?
I'm going to defer to Marshall. I think we're looking at, what, $700,000 or $800,000?
That's correct, at this time. Phase two is the way that it's looking at being structured. It could just be concentrating strictly in Heritage Hall. It may be the bathrooms and the lobby. It, you know, we're looking at all three of these pieces to see time schedule wise as to what we can do. You know, we are so event driven there that we've been very, very fortunate to not have to tell an event, well, we can't do you. We've been able to keep the events going and keep everything moving by just shuffling events around in the building. And that's very important, is to be sure that we stay operational and we keep everything going. So,
what did you say that amount was? I'm sorry.
Around $700,000-$800,000.
So almost the same amount of what we spent on phase one.
It could be, ma'am. It just depends upon how much of a big chunk we have the time frame to be able to accomplish.
Right.
In any way, is it going to be less than $138,000?
No.
Any chance?
Yeah.
No. Okay. Got it.
No. But that $138,000 would really help.
Got it.
Okay.
All right. Thank you. Okay. Sorry to shove the little brother in the corner, but we kind of had to ask all those questions to get the whole big picture. Thank you for your patience, Mr. Snyder. Any more questions of Mr. Snyder?
No.
Okay. Thank you. If not, I'll open it up to public comment. Seeing that there is none, I will bring it back to the Commission for action.
Mayor, I move that we approve change order number one with Chevron Energy Solution Overland Park, Kansas, number 08-2742, be approved and those funds be available to be used in phase two of the Bicentennial Center project.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we approve change order number one with the Chevron Energy Conservation Project number 08-2742 in the amount of $138,147.51, which we will then use for towards the phase two of the Bicentennial Center. All those in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed say nay. Motion passes 5-0.
Item 8.5, approval of an engineering agreement for street and stormwater improvement construction plans for the intersection of Marymount Road and Glen Avenue, project number 082712.
Mr. Stack.
Thank you, Mayor and Commissioners. This request is for some design help for a project that we have in the 2009 sub-CIP, which is the concrete street rehab of Marymount Road between Iron and Crawford Street. An area of concern for many years has been the Glen Avenue intersection and the drainage in that area. And so looking into that further, it's not an easy solution and one that we thought we could use a little help on. We've currently got the plans almost ready to go in-house with our staff to repair and a little bit of realignment, looking at adding a sidewalk, as you discussed last week at the comp plan meeting, Mayor, just to
thank you.
Try and get that in there. And we've thought about that as well. And so this would be a project. The Marymount Road project will be a project that will really hopefully enhance that whole street once and for all. However, with the storm drainage challenges we have, we don't want to minimize that and have to rip it up again in 5 to 10 years. So we just really want to get that right. And these guys that we are looking to hire, RMA Engineering, one of their main focuses is stormwater engineering. He's currently working on his PhD through K-State for urban stormwater, so we feel like if anybody's going to help us figure this out, he can. And then they're also going to put together the plans for the intersection improvements, which will be a big help to us. Entertain questions.
What on this map?
Yes.
What are all those yellow lines?
The yellow lines are contours, I believe. Yep. Those probably don't help you very much.
Okay. Well,
they help me, but yeah.
Okay. I couldn't figure out what they were.
Very confusing, yes. Okay.
How about the red lines?
The red lines are storm sewer lines, actually. Okay. So those are a little more applicable. Contours and storm sewer lines are really what we're focusing on here. But yes, that doesn't help because I don't have a legend on there. So yeah, those are actually the storm water lines.
Is it possible for us to extend the blue line past 1300 elevation, being familiar with that area? And I know it says approximately.
Right.
And maybe when they get into the study, they'll see. But there's a quite a big dip in the road there, and there's a lot of water that will stand across there, which would be that intersection, the intersection of
Claremont. Okay.
And Glen, yeah.
So there's a local drainage area.
Yeah,
the
city redid that stretch of Glen asphalting a year or two ago, I believe. And looking in the wrong direction. And just on the west edge of that, there's always been a pretty big drop that I think might be intentional to get the water one way or the other, but that's a pretty big standing water pattern. So, just for my own clarity, right, that they're kind of looking at the whole area.
Yeah, we definitely, Claremont, we can look at that. If it's no further west than Claremont, we can definitely, okay, that'll work. Yeah, yeah, there's existing pavement that kind of goes to the east side of Claremont, and then there's ditches after that, so we were going to look at that whole area, basically, and we'll just continue to the other side.
Dan, correct me if I'm wrong, but this is a not-to-exceed amount.
That's correct.
We will need to speak with the consultant about whether that would fit within the scope.
Right.
But we can get
that's kind of the reason for raising it right now.
Yeah, I think we can get that done.
And did I understand you correctly that you believe that after this phase we will be working on Marymount Road?
That's correct.
I've had a lot of phone calls still about Marymount Road, so.
What kind of phone calls? Just curious, so I don't miss it. The pavement or drainage or sidewalks or?
Just.
Yes.
Yes.
Get it all.
All of the above.
Anything
all
I'm missing?
Of the above.
I'll make
from
sure
Crawford
I don't miss
to Iron. From Crawford to Iron.
Okay.
Okay.
Stacks on the job.
And we're trying.
Thank
you. I drive it every day, and it's definitely a problem. So
yeah,
try and get it
fixed.
Do
you bounce like this?
Yes.
Yeah.
It's very bumpy.
Then
it's
you
been
know
around
what
a long time.
About.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Stack. At this time, I'll open it up to public comment. Seeing that there is none, I'll bring it back to the commission for action.
Mayor, I'd like to make a motion that we approve an engineering agreement for street and stormwater improvement construction plans for the intersection of Marymount Road and Glen Avenue, project number 082712, with RMA Engineering LLC in the amount not to exceed $23,400.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we approve the engineering agreement with RMA for an amount not to exceed $23,400 for street and stormwater improvement construction plans for the intersection of Marymount Road and Glen Avenue, city project number 08-2712. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay. Motion passes 5-0.
Item 8.6, approve of a construction change order to the contract for phase one of renovations to the Bicentennial Center.
Mr. Marsh, Mr. Perry.
Hello again. Smile if you'll turn those lights off for us, please. This is a kind of a ugly picture, as you can see. This is you have in Heritage Hall, this is a problem that we did not know about. We had no idea this was going to occur. We have daubs of black glue that are on the cinder block walls that you can see right there. They're in, some of them are in like long stripes, some of them are just in little globs that was holding the old Tectum panels that was on the walls for sound absorption inside of Heritage Hall. You can see also in there's a brown matter that is up there at the very top of the slide. We, in doing this entire construction project, anytime we come across something or do something, Mr. Byron Erickson has been very helpful in getting us to, we take samples and be sure that everything we're doing is clear and clean of asbestos. And through this project so far, everything has been coming out great until now. Next slide, please. You can see they are in varying shapes and varying sizes, and they were being used to hold insulation under the tectum panels, as well as hold some of the edges of the tectum panels up to the walls in Heritage Hall. Next. Here you can see, this is Steve Adams, our city electrician, is showing this is a very long stripe of it that is on the wall that was holding a very narrow section of the tectum panel up between a door to the maintenance area in Heritage Hall and the fire hose panel. Next slide. The total length of that stripe of it was just about 39 inches long. It is, as you can see in that picture right there, the cinder blocks are essentially porous. They're very, you know, a very rough material, to where the black glue is essentially kind of down in there. And the only way to effectively remove this would be to grind it off the walls, which would impact our timetable greatly. Next slide. And as you can see, this is a large section of wall where it's just all over, just kind of daubed. And there's sections where you can barely make it out. There's the brown glue that was also used, that where it was just kind of daubed. And the problem that you've got here is the fact that in the next slide, please, is that it was kind of intermixed. Some areas had the brown glue, some areas had the black glue. And then the next slide you'll see has no black glue whatsoever. So it's kind of interspersed all around the room. It's not like just in one area. It'd be like an area, then a non-area, then an area, then a non-area. But it's about 40% of the area inside of Heritage Hall. In examining this problem, we discussed it with the representatives from Jones, Gillum, Renz, and with Mr. Erickson, that the simplest way and most cost-effective way to handle this that would not impact our timeline with any additional days to the project would be to sheetrock it and encapsulate this to where it could not be touched, bothered, or dealt with, or in any way, shape, or form. And that's what we're looking at doing, is being able to put, that is about a almost 8-foot strip there from that is on the wall where the tectum panels used to be. We'll be using a 10-foot section of sheetrock that'll be furred out to get it the correct depth on there, so we'll be able to put it up there and it'll stay. It'll be long lasting. The acoustic panels will go on the top of that. That'll be interspersed. It won't be butted up one next to each other like the tectum panels would, and it'll be an effective way to do this so that it will not we want to try to make it, you know, look as smooth and as consistent all the way around the room.
If I could add a couple of details. Byron Erickson is an EPA licensed asbestos inspector on behalf of the city, and so he explained his involvement. In terms of the three options that were identified, Marshall mentioned grinding, which we kind of ruled out as being problematic both in terms of practicality and cost, and then that left two options. One was trying to glue some cinder blocks in isolated locations, and that had an initial cost of $30,000, and then the cosmetic work to get that all to tie back in was probably another $10,000,
right.
Or the solution that we're recommending, which is the encapsulation at a total cost of $35,534. So the proposed alternative option is the most cost-effective, and it has the added benefit of not negatively impacting the timeline.
Who thought to test the glue for asbestos?
We did.
What made you think of that?
Anything that we keep finding, we're going to make sure that everything is tested, that there's no problems, no issues with it whatsoever. We want to be sure this building is clean, this building is in good shape for the future, to where, you know, 30 years from now, if they do this again, they won't be running into the same kind of problems. We checked, you know, when we popped up floor tiles.
I can understand, yeah. Tiles. I just don't traditionally think of glue as containing asbestos.
Well, actually, Mr. Erickson and I were just talking about that before the meeting, and he said that from the time period prior to 1979, if they still had the product on the shelves, a contractor did, they could still utilize it for a period of time. And since this was built back in the late 70s, if they owned it, they could still use it.
We actually went into this project with a testing protocol in place, identifying that we were going to do this.
Mm-hmm. And this is still safe. I mean, this is still,
yes, ma'am,
to go ahead and cover it up with the sheetrock, and mm-hmm. like you said, you're not disturbing anything, so it's not going to cause any mm-hmm. safety issues.
That's correct. Yes, ma'am.
And you're going at an elevation where you're not going to have to do all of the electrical boxes and everything that are down below. This is kind of just over where the panels were, so your big electrical boxes, the fire hose box, those you're going to have to frame around, but pretty much have minimized it to keep the cost down.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
And the option you're proposing doesn't have the additional cost for the cosmetic changes. It's just the $35,500.
What this will do, ma'am, is when we put these put the sheetrock up there, that includes taping it, you know,
that
where
includes
they
everything.
They smooth it all out, and then it'll then rather than painting the block wall, we'd be painting this. So
it includes the cosmetic. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am.
And then you do you think you'll still need acoustic tiles even with the sheetrock up?
Yes, sir. What these acoustic tiles not only do is they are sound absorption, but they're decorative.
Oh, okay.
And it'll really enhance and kind of make the whole look in there.
Break up the massive wall.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Because before you were just going to paint that block?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So this will look much better.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Any other questions of Mr. Perry? Thank you. I'll open it up to public comment. Seeing that there is none, I'll go ahead and bring it back to the commission for action.
Mayor, I'd move we approve you to execute a change order in a form approved by the city attorney and city manager with Cheney Construction for asbestos encapsulation in an amount not to exceed $35,534.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we approve and authorize the change order to the contract of Phase 1 renovations of the Bicentennial Center in an amount not to exceed $35,534. All those in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed say nay. Motion passes 5-0.
Mayor, I'd move we recess into executive session for 10 minutes to discuss with legal counsel matters subject to the attorney-client privilege for the reason that public discussion of those matters would waive the privilege and adversely affect the city's interest in the matters, and reconvene in this room at 5:09 p.m.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we recess into executive session. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed say nay. Motion passes. We are in executive session until 5:09. Do you anticipate action?
No, we do not.
Okay, thank you. We are in executive session.